Hi, Nana. Hi, Natalia. Okay, so we're just waiting for the lovely Kemi Shade. There she is.
Hey, you.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good,
How
good
was
as
your day
well. But
today?
do you know what? It was a good day.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, it was a busy but a good day. I feel like completely shattered
Oh,
and
good.
hungry, but it was a good
Yeah,
day.
I'm hungry too. I literally just dashed in the house about 10 minutes ago. I'm like, okay, no
Oh,
one
you've been
speak
so.
to me
I know.
for
We're
the
gonna
next
do it. We're
hour.
gonna do
Yeah,
it.
don't breathe,
We're gonna.
don't speak,
Yeah,
nothing.
just get on it. I'll get on it. Everyone, welcome to our usual weekly Karakurv sessions where we invite amazing experts around textured hair to talk to us all about hair. And today we've got our very own personal hair coach here at Kara, Kemi Shade, who
Hey.
has over 15 years' experience as an educator
Yeah.
and a stylist in this space. So she knows exactly, you know what you're talking about. Like,
I
I
think I
remember when
do.
we
I
had.
think I do. I think so. I would like
You
to
know, I
think
remember,
so.
like, I still like remember, like, our, like, literally, like, our sessions that we have talking about hair, or like when I did my Cara session with you. Like, I still remember when you were like, I was using like blunt scissors to trim my hair.
Yeah, we'll talk about all those things. We'll get there. We will make those
We'll get onto
mistakes.
that, won't we? We'll get onto that, but I can
Yeah.
never remember. I can never forget, rather. But anyway, guys, this is Kemi Sade. Kemi Sade, do you want to give an additional intro so we can get to know you before we launch?
I mean, you've pretty much said everything. I live and breathe everything here. As long as there's hair growing on someone, I'm your girl, so to speak. I don't know, I can never get tired of it. So, and I mean, we learn every time. I can't say that I know everything, but I'm learning to know everything. And the industry is obviously ever changing, and it's always kind of eventually when people make all the mistakes that they've made, they tend to come back to the original OGs, which are your hairstylists, hopefully that they know what they're doing. Or people like us who have obviously trained in doing hair for a long time and just given up the salon status. So, I mean, it's just one of those things. And I'm always very passionate, especially, I think my passion is really for children because I know that we adults, we've made all
Yeah,
these
we did
mistakes.
actually mention that.
And then when I see the same mistakes being made at children, I'm thinking, no, we know better. We should give them a better chance at loving what's coming out their scalp, because at the end of the day, my policy is you can't control what's growing out of your scalp, but you can maintain what's on there. So that's pretty me, not me in a nutshell. Sometimes I come with a sledgehammer, sometimes I come in correcting in love. But I always just like to see the
But
quick.
I have to say, it always feels like it's still couched with a healthy dose of empathy. Like, it's
I
never
like to think
scary.
so. I like to think that that's my approach now. It wasn't like that before. I think obviously as you deal with different, for me, as I deal with different clients, you start to realize that people and hair care, it depends on their emotional state. It could also mean some things that they're going through or some things they just never had a clue about. And you always have to, I think as hairstylists or hair educators, we also have to, as much as we want people to change, we also have to think about where they're coming from and how that really affects how they view their hair or just even looking after themselves generally. And I've always found that it's a side-by-side thing. If you generally don't care about your hair, then there's something going on with that person. They're either stressed or they're going through a really tough time, or it's just something that they've never thought about that is important to them. So I think it's one of those things where it's like a holistic, they always say that you're, especially if you go to a salon, you find that someone doing your hair, you kind of spill the beans to them. So it's kind of like you're getting your hair done and you're getting therapy at the same time.
Yeah,
So yeah, it's one
there's
of those
definitely
things. And
that.
then you find that it's kind of hand in hand. It's just like pretty much when you go to your GP and you say, oh, I'm feeling this. The first thing the GP will say to you is, what are you doing? What's your lifestyle like? How are you feeling? So it's just generally the same thing with hair or skin. All those things are what's going on with that person. So I think, yeah. And I think that's where,
Absolutely.
yeah, that's where my passion comes in as well, just to kind of be there to do the best that I can.
That's so amazing because I think, like, in addition to what you said, it's there's also the thing of like people we just never learned. So, like,
Yeah.
it's like I had an interest in my hair, but I just didn't know. I didn't know that it was even curly because I never really
Gave
had an
it a
opportunity
chance.
to know. I never had that opportunity to know. I think, like, you know, like obviously when we speak to people who are using Kara, especially when they kind of like want to chat to me first, you know, in our discovery calls, you hear these things and it's nice that, you know, there's kind of like this safe space where it's like, you're welcome here. But today we're going to be talking about winter hair care. And we've kind of called it, what the heck is winter hair care? So maybe the best place to start would actually be to discuss, does the hair change with the seasons? Does your hair, how does, or rather, maybe actually,
Does it
a
behave
better way to ask
differently?
that question is, how does the change in weather affect the hair before we then go into winter?
Change in weather affects the behavior, the way the hair behaves, right? So it's like I like to use daily things that we are used to. So if I'm extremely hungry, there's a certain way I'll behave, right? I won't be this nice and smiley. If I am tired, there's a way I would behave. It doesn't mean that it doesn't change who I'm not. It doesn't change me as a woman or female, you know what I mean? I still remain who I am, but put me in certain environments, then certain things will come out. So,
That's a really good analogy. It's like when you're hungry, you go to the supermarket and you buy all the stuff that
everything,
you don't need.
and it's not a great
Okay,
time
all
to have a
right.
sensible conversation with me or start an argument with me because it's going to go another way. If I'm hormonal, if it's that time of the month, there's certain things I will not be great at doing, which means holding a decent conversation if I'm upset about something. So it's the same way with hair. So you put hair or you put yourself in certain environments, whether it's extremely wet, if it's extremely cold, extremely hot, the hair would behave a certain way. And it's just that. The same thing with the skin as well. You're in extreme weather conditions or change in weather, your skin would react in that way. So that's just the same with hair. The hair doesn't necessarily the texture or whatever of the hair doesn't change, but the way hair will behave a certain way and it will start to show you signals. So that's why in winter, sometimes I tell people, pretty much winter, if you are looking after your hair generally properly, it's the same routine. You just up it a bit. So you give it like the extra oomph. So whatever you're doing, maybe you're doing it 20% more or 30% more, depending on what the hair wants and what the hair requires. So most people think that it's like a complete overhaul. For some, maybe it's a complete overhaul. I think it depends on
I guess it depends on what stage
what stage
you're
the
at,
hair
like
is.
where you're at in terms of what it is that you're actually doing at this point in
Exactly.
time.
Exactly. So with winter hair care, it's just look at your current routine and then look at what your hair is telling you. Because your hair was, so for instance, it's been really cold for the last few days. I've got my hair in braids, so I've not, my hair hasn't noticed that change. But once these braids come out this weekend, yay, then there's certain things I will probably have to do and do a bit more of.
Could you tell us a little bit more of what those things are?
So, I mean, it depends. I mean, I can give different, it's different spectrums, right?
Of
So
course,
I
of
would say,
course.
okay, let's start by if your hair is in its natural state. So you've got your hair in a fro like you have. Let's use you as an example now. In the last 2 days, it would have been extremely, it would have felt a bit tight. It would have felt very cold. Sorry, cold, not cold, dry and brittle. It would feel that way. Not necessarily that that's what the hair is because it's cold outside. And then you come into the house, the heating is on. You've got the warmth, and then you're outside again. It's cold. You get in your car. So there's extremities of the weather that's going on. So in certain circumstances, if you decide that you want to leave your hair out completely in the winter, I would say that I'm always a, no matter the season of the year, your leave-in conditioner should be like glued to you, like your life depended on it, right? So that's the thing about with winter hair, if you decide to leave your hair out. So you have your leave-in conditioner. I mean, you could always put that every 2 to 3 days. Again, it depends on what how your hair is behaving. And then there are different types of leave-in conditioners. So there would be the extremely watery ones, which you could use throughout the year. For some people, you'll find that that's not enough moisture, that's not enough boost for them. So they might have to use more creamier, like custardy textured
Things that are a
leave-in
bit
conditioner.
thicker.
A bit thicker. However, with that as well, it depends on what your hair type. If I've got
Of
fine
course.
hair, So I've got fine hair. I can't use thick. So I usually say that the thick leave-it conditions are the ones that you can scoop. They're usually the ones in the jar that you can scoop.
They're like butter.
They're like butter. They're quite thick. They're custardy in texture. I can't really use that because it weighs my own hair down. So if I have to use that, again, which is always what I tell people, you can't go by just general textbook. You have to understand what your hair is saying. So for finer hair textures, you can try to use the thicker ones, but use them at night. So that it's, and you're light-handed with it, put a little bit on, wrap your hair at night, and then go to bed. But using it and slapping it on during the day, it's just going to weigh your hair down. It's going to feel dull. Okay. It's going to weigh it down. And then you'll be like, oh, my hair feels sticky. It feels dry. It's not clumpy. It's clumpy. It's not, you know, it's not free-flowing. Or depending on what it is, whatever style choice you choose, exactly. So for finer hair textures, really the thicker ones may not necessarily be your friend, but you could be light-handed with it and then use it as an overnight. So put it in your hair at night, wrap your hair, and then in the morning, it's had time to sit in compared with someone that has a more denser hair texture that is just, it would just soak it up. So those sort of things are quite, I mean, with winter hair care, again, is always what is your hair saying and what style choice are you choosing to go for? Then that will determine, again, if you've got your hair out like you have at the moment, I would say at night, just make sure that your ends are twisted, tucked away, so that you're not always.
I feel like I need to report myself to you.
Yeah, so it's not like you're always. And then again, even if you decide to leave your hair, you have to also be mindful of manipulators or your hands in it today, tomorrow, every hour. Yeah. Like it, those sort of things would also make it, would cause it to break and just stress the hair out. And then always just use a deep conditioner. Like I don't even do the conditioner, just skip. Just go straight to your deep conditioner. Make sure that after you wash your hair, you use a deep conditioner. And most people find that in the winter when they apply heat, which means that you probably use like one of those heat caps, the electric ones.
Yeah.
Or they're really nice ones now that you could put in the microwave for a few seconds and then pop that on.
Yeah.
Or go to a salon if you're not the hair type person. Go to a salon, get a deep conditioning treatment with the steam hood. And if you do that more regularly, so if you're someone that this is a salon maybe every 2 weeks, then that's something you do.
Okay.
If you wash your hair every week, I just suggest just deep condition your hair. It's just extra 15, 20 minutes. Again, we're not leaving deep conditioners on for like hours and overnight.
Yeah. Okay. I've got that question. Definitely. Okay. Let's hold that for a minute.
Okay.
But I've got a question for you around, you know, textures of hair. Mm-hmm. So for textures like mine, you know, you often hear, oh, it's wintertime, put your hair in braids. Or in wintertime, you tuck your hair away.
Mm-hmm.
Can we talk about, so first question, what are the benefits of tucking your hair away? And then what if you don't want to tuck your hair away? Mm-hmm. Maybe you have a looser curl texture and you don't normally wear braids. Maybe you only wear braids in the summer, or maybe you just don't wear braids at all.
Mm-hmm.
So what should customers who are on the tight spectrum do? Must they tuck their hair away in braids or some other style?
Yeah.
And what if you don't have tight textures? What do you do? And how do you kind of like process this thing around winter hair care or caring for your hair during the winter?
Yeah. So I mean, usually when people say, "Oh, in the winter I do protective style, which is braids," so like me, is it technically I put protective style with an air quote, right? Because what protective styling is meant to do, whatever it is, whatever choice you make, is meant to prevent you from manipulating your hair every day.
Okay.
Now, it's no longer protective if it's doing the opposite. So if I take these braids out, my hair is extremely breaking or extremely dry after I take this out. It no longer did what it was supposed to do. It's no longer protective.
Okay.
Right. So the notion that, oh, I have to put my hair in braids in winter, it's not set in stone. So there's no rule. That sort of rule, it does not apply. If you don't want to put your hair in braids, that's fine. If you don't want to put it in combros, again, that's fine. My thing is always that make sure that you're switching things up. So if you have your hair in a bun like this week, don't keep your hair in a high bun all the time, because then again, that's just unnecessary pressure. Sometimes you can leave them in big chunky twists and twist your own hair in chunky twists, and you can either leave them down or leave them packed up. As long as it's not something that you're having to deal with the hair every single day. And when I mean deal, so that's also for natural hair. Now for relaxed hair on the other side, yeah, we do have to comb the hair. You wake up in the morning, you have to comb the hair, but you're not styling consistently. Something that prevents you from styling your hair consistently. And again, that varies. Some people are able to put their hair in a bun and leave it like that for the week, just wrap around it, and then they just kind of twist up the loose ends if they want to. And then just leave that in there, and if they have anywhere fancy to go to, they can loosen up the twist and just kind of let that rock on into a fro. Again, it's a choice that you choose. I don't know if what I'm saying is making sense.
It does, as long as it's
my thing with winter hair care, or protect, what you call protect styling, is as long as it's not something that's stressing your hair every day, and you're not constantly. So if you decide to do what they call the twist out right now, so you could twist your hair up for a little while, and then maybe on day two you unravel the twist. But the good thing, the thing about it is that those twists, after a while throughout the day, will start to loosen in texture. That means tomorrow, tonight, you have to put it back in twist, unravel it again tomorrow. That's too much. So if you decide to do a twist out, maybe do it for like halfway through the week, and then you just twist it back up and forget about it. Or you just twist your hair in the week, and then at the weekend, if you've got somewhere really nice to go, or you just want to, you know, switch up your style, then you take out the twist, leave it in the twist out again with your scarf or bonnet or whatever it is that you need to protect your hair at night. But as long as we're not putting our hands in it, taking it out, all that every time. So that's for someone who decides that I don't want to do braids, and that's fine. You don't have to do braids, because again, braids are not necessarily the best hairstyles. I've
It's an aesthetic choice.
It is an aesthetic choice, to be honest with you.
It's okay. It's okay.
And it's okay if you don't like it, if you don't want to do it. I've even had to learn over the years the type of braids and how long I can keep it for that my hair likes. The maximum I can do for myself is 5 weeks. And I had to learn that the hard way. As much as I love braids, I had to learn that the hard way. And then decided, okay, this is what works. And when I'm getting my hair braided, I'm telling the braider, no, you're not doing that. This is what we're doing. And we formed a bond now. Like, I don't even need to say much. So, and 5 weeks, 4 weeks, it's coming out.
It's time to come out.
And I give the hair a break. So again, some people just do the back to back. What are you doing when you take it out? What are the things that you're doing before you install your braids? If you're doing cornrows or Ghana weave, I'm not a fan of that Ghana plaits.
It seems to have broken up. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah.
There's certain style choices I'm not a fan of because they have a history of breaking, especially if anything that's messing with your hairline,
kind of like your edges,
anything that messes with your hairline is not protective style.
That's
relative. Some people would do it and they wouldn't even feel a drop of hair off. That's fine. If you do feel that patch and you see a patch that your thumb can fit or your finger can fit, and that's, you've done that hairstyle, that was not for you. You need to let go. You need to let it
go. So we need to tell all the aunties that are braiding our hair, putting our cornrows in, to just be super gentle when they're braiding our hair.
Either you're super gentle or you stay away from the style as much as...
Okay.
I mean, it's kind of like you have to decide, do I want to choose aesthetics over, like, am I deciding to be bald
So wait, is there no in-between at all when
there
it comes
to... I mean, they're in between. For me, my in-between was when I discovered Knotless, right? And I thought, whoa.
Okay.
Whoever created that made it for fine texture hair people like us, where our hair does not like the braid started, the extension started at the beginning. Yeah. And I had to give up on braids for a long time. It was only in the lockdown that I thought, ooh, okay, this works for me. But then... if there wasn't no Knotless, I would have given up on braids completely. Like,
so you weren't, I mean, you're wearing Knotless now. Can you come closer? Yes, I can see. Okay.
Hair texture is very curly and very fine. So they're not picking that. They're not picking that. No, thank you. I don't care if it's not neat in the front. I'm not after that. Just leave it alone.
That's totally fine. Yeah. I think we've moved over from like the overt, like, oh my God, it needs to be like crazy neat. Yeah. Like it doesn't need to look like that anymore.
Exactly.
I think mine is probably somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
It's probably somewhere in the middle. Okay. All right. So let's talk about, by the way, guys, if you've got any questions, just pop it into the chat. whilst Kamishada and I are just nattering on about all things hair care, specifically as related to the seasons and the winter. So you mentioned something earlier that I was like, let's come back to it, let's come back to it, let's come back to it. Winter hair, sorry, not winter hair care. Keeping your conditioner on overnight. So yes, keeping your conditioner on overnight.
Don't do it.
Why is that? Yeah, why is that a bad idea?
Because first of all, I always say, what does the pro I tell my clients, can you get your jar of conditioner and read what it says on the label? Just read what it says on the label. If it's
Okay.
most times you would get the 15 to 20, 15 minutes or 20 minutes on the
Yeah.
packaging. I doubt if you would actually get any deep conditioner that says you should leave overnight. I think
Okay.
I can bet a few couple of hundred of pounds for that. You will
Okay.
not find. There might be overnight treatments, which could be your thicker hair moisturizers that you can leave in your
Okay.
hair overnight, because they're quite thick, so it gives time for it to absorb. But then they're moisturizers, they're leave-in, right? That's
Yeah.
different. But you would not find a conditioner or a dip conditioner that says live up to an hour. Most of them would even say maybe 30 minutes with heat or without, or 25 to 30 minutes. You would never find anything that says leave for a couple of hours while you go to the store and do your errands.
So
And that's because,
why is it a bad idea to do that? What does that damage the hair?
so I was even going to say that's because when these products are created in the labs, they
Okay.
are obviously tested for the
Right.
specific reason. So if it's supposed to be hydrating or nourishing or replenishing, blah, 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 all those sort of words, they would have tested to know the maximum effect for that product to be, it's law of diminishing returns, right?
Okay.
Maximum effect that product would penetrate the hair shaft to do what it needs to do and get out of
Okay.
there. When we
Okay.
leave it for
Okay.
longer, what you're now doing is, especially with the hair shaft, is like you're making it overexpand. The
Yeah.
product has now made the hair complete, and then you rinse off. So your hair can absorb so much water or so much
I
moisture in that
see.
it literally kind of makes it weak.
Okay.
And when there's
Okay.
so much moisture in that in your hair shaft, these are things that you can't see with your naked eye. But if you look through it, maybe through under a microscope or whatever it is, over time it makes that hair weak, and then it breaks off easily. It may not
I
look
see.
weak when you blow dry and you're thinking, oh, my hair was so soft. That's what most people say. It was super soft, super manageable when I left it in for 3 hours or overnight and I woke up, my hair was just like silk. Yeah, that was just an effect right now.
Okay.
But then doing that over time, you're actually just making the hair weak. It can't withstand anything, and at the slightest thing, it just completely breaks off. So again, I just always say stick to the instructions on the packaging. They're
Okay.
tested in the labs for that reason.
Okay.
Water, I always say this to clients all the time. You drink water. Water is good for everyone. Conditioner is good for everyone. Deep conditioner. If I drink too much water, I will probably start to feel sick. And if I do that, if I decide to go on a water diet for a long time and drink so much water, it starts to my organs and over so my I'm overworking the organs to process all that water. The
Yeah.
same way with deep conditioner, you're overprocessing the hair shaft to work through that product, and then it goes, it's kind of like, yeah, you've exhausted it, so it goes limp on you and it gets weak on you, and then that's where the brittleness can kick in, and you can, once the hair's brittle, it will break. So that's one of the reasons why we always say, don't leave conditioners or deep conditioners in overnight. Don't leave it for an hour. Don't leave it for two. If you have to leave
Okay.
anything in your hair for that long, that means that that product is not the right product for you. Not necessarily mean it's a bad one, but it's not doing enough for your hair. You need to find something else that would be more effective in a shorter period of time.
Yeah. Do you know what? This is actually really, really comforting to hear because, typically we hear about, oh my God, it's wash day. Oh my God, we need a whole day to do wash day, or we need half a day to do wash day. But it's actually, first of all, like the fact that we even have a name for it is like a big massive question mark. But it speaks to just how difficult it is, of course. But I think that, like it's comforting to hear that it's okay to follow the instructions on the bottle. It's okay if the product says, we've tested it deep conditioning for like 5 minutes or 5 to 15 minutes, it's okay to do that because that actually cuts the time that you spend in brushing your hair by half. Because presumably, like, if we're having to leave it for, say, for instance, 3 hours plus, that's like 3 hours
that you've just wasted kind doing of, nothing.
Three hours that you're maybe indoors. I mean, when I used to do this before you came along, I would like put the deep conditioner on, put the cap on, put my scarf on, and I'd run errands. And I'm like, all of you guys don't know I'm deep conditioning right now. Yeah, I'm totally multitasking. But of course, you know, like, not everybody does that. Mm. And it's comforting to know you can cut the time you spend.
I don't even
when
like
washing your hair.
Yeah, wash day. I mean, it's like, why? I mean, I would say wash. I like to say wash hour, and then people are like, I can't wash
hour.
Yes, you can. Now, depending on the length of your hair, you can add the extra 15 minutes, but it's always processing. And we've already told ourselves it's a cumbersome task. And I think that usually comes from the fact that, you know, before people go to the salon and it takes the whole day in the salon where you wash your hair, leave you under the dryer for like 45 minutes, which I don't know why, and then forget about you. And once that's
that was just the time management thing because they're plumbing so much hair.
So we've associated that with, even if I want to wash my hair, when I wash my hair start to finish, 40 minutes. If I'm being slow, maybe an hour. And that's because you need to think about your phasing, how you are starting to wash your hair. So, and again, in the winter, obviously, you don't want to be cold with water and conditioner in your hair. Because one, you're even just, it's not necessary. And then if you're going out in the cold and you're wrapping, as much as you wrap your hair, it's still cold weather with all these products in your hair. And you're going to actually make the hair get weaker and more brittle with all that extra cold air, moisture. It's just too much
the
for
heat,
hair, right?
Sorry, not the heat, the cold weather, especially when it's icy. If you go out when your hair's
you
wet.
Don't even need to catch a cold because you're washing your hair for the whole day. It's not necessary. Yeah. I always say start with sections, depending on how thick or long your hair. Start to section your hair. You could do it in 2 sections, in 4, in 3, depending on the density or the length of the hair. Okay. Yeah. Start by detangle as the first thing that you can, comb it through as much as you can, and then wash in sections. Then that way you're not overwhelmed. If you wash in sections, you're not trying to use your whole hand to attack your whole head. It's
kind of like go all in.
Don't go all hands in. Wash your hair, always do it in sections. It's much easier manageable. Your finger pads can actually wash your scalp properly. So I don't want to give too many tips away, but we can always manage that. And then you leave your deep conditioner in for 20 minutes maximum or 25. Yeah. And then you rinse it off, you put your leave-in conditioner in and bam. And you can see how you don't need it for an hour. You don't, if you even have to do 25 minutes, that's obviously you've got your heat cap on and you have, I don't have the patience for 25 minutes. I don't know about you. I don't. The most I do is 20 minutes and it's my timer is on my phone because I need to get out.
You actually put a timer on when you're...
I put a timer on. You have to. Otherwise,
that's crazy.
Before you know it, you're watching TV and an hour, 2 hours is gone and you don't need that. So I time myself 20 minutes. I jump in the shower, wash my hair, put the deep conditioner on and 20 minutes. And it'll probably be, I usually call wash day my own sanitation day. So I can, if I have to shave, if I have to use a body scrub, I'm taking my time.
Yeah, you get everything done all at once.
Okay. Steam in the shower would also help. And in 20 minutes or 25 minutes, depending on what type of day it is, I rinse my hair and I'm done and out of the shower and I can do all the other bits. Now, styling can take longer, which is what most people get wrong. But you always just put a timer on your phone. I always do that. Or if it's a favorite song that you like, if it's for 5 minutes, then you can put it on repeat 4 times if that's what you like to do. Yeah, just do something that will make you realize 20 minutes is up or 15 minutes is up. And then you just do that. Yeah. And then you rinse. So, but then most people confuse styling and washing. So once you start to finish, you really shouldn't be taking more than 30 minutes from start to finish wash. Depends on your hair length or density. And then the styling
the wash
choice.
Hour.
Yeah. So that's why I call it wash hour. But then the styling, depending on what you choose to style your, how you choose to style your, may take longer, but that's completely different. But washing your hair shouldn't take the whole day. It really shouldn't.
Okay. All right. All right, I see Fee Bams. It says she uses a timer as well. Look at you guys.
There you go. Yeah.
Time management queens.
Yeah.
Using a timer. Okay, I need to do that next time I wash my hair. I'm going to report back.
Free yourself, people.
I'm gonna report back. So some like time management hacks there. Use a timer or play your music back to back, or just kind of actually just take comfort in the fact that the products have been tested, and that if you're using a product that doesn't feel like you're getting all the benefits, you probably want to check to find out if that's the right product for your hair texture, for your lifestyle, for the season, wherever it is you're based, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
And just always read instructions. Always read the label, or even on your shampoo. Because we always
what if you don't know how to read a label? We don't all know how to read labels.
The directions are always there. If you buy any product, I promise everyone here to go to their cabinet and look at your shampoo and your deep conditioner. There's always instructions on there. But because we think we know how to use them, we just slap it on. You know, some people put conditioner on their scalp. I'm not going to talk about that. That's a discussion for another day. It says apply to your hair, root to tip. Like, read instructions. No matter how many times you've bought that product, still read instructions if you can.
Okay. It's like, just in case
it's a change. Because sometimes, you never know. And if you're using shampoos or conditioners that are for certain scalp treatments or certain scalp conditions, some conditioners would say you can apply it to the scalp depending on what type of conditioner it is. If it's
and depending on what type of formulation it is. We spoke about formulation last week.
So you always have to read. I'm not going to pick up paracetamol and assume because it says take two, I will take two. Still read it. You still need to read what it says for you to do. Always read the instructions on the label. Even if it's your leave-in conditioner, even if it's a hair mist, read what it says. If it says spray on your hair, just spray on your hair, not on your scalp. You know what I mean? So those sort of things are just, and it just makes your hair care routine simple. It's second nature to you. And then with the winter, just up whatever it is that you're doing. If you're not using a leave-in conditioner right now, I would suggest just go online, do your research, or go to the store and figure out which one it's best for you. But leave-in conditioners are your like go-to every time. You know me, I'm always all for leave-in conditioners.
Yes, of course.
Same way you put lotion on your body, use your leave-in conditioner all the time.
Oh my god, like, this is amazing. Thank you so much for the gems. For anyone who's just joining us, we've just been talking, this segment is called What the Heck is Winter Skincare? And we started with talking about, okay, how does the season, actually my first question was like, does your hair change with the seasons? Like, you give a very nice analogy where you were like, actually, it's all about how it behaves. So for instance, if we're hungry, we behave in a certain way. Like, if you're hungry and you go to a store to buy food, you behave in a certain way. Or if you're hungry and someone's suddenly wanted to have a discussion, that conversation might go completely differently. So I think it's, that was such a like a useful analogy to know that, okay, our hair might behave in a certain way when all of a sudden we just literally went from like 15 degrees to -1. Of course it's going to be in some sort of a shock. So it helps to kind of like think about it in those terms. And you were also talking about thinking about almost like upping our routine, so we're doing something kind of like putting that up a notch. But I think the most useful point there is that it also depends on what you're doing, whether you are doing the, whether you are following the right routine for your texture in the first place, for your texture, your lifestyle, your goals, your age, etc. And if you are, say for instance, you've had your chiro session and you know you've got your right routine, you've got your right product, it's a case of kind of like moving that up a notch.
And some super people helpful. May find that they may, maybe if they use lighter textures, leave-in conditioners in non-winter months. So when I mean non-winter, winter, I mean from spring all the way to autumn. And once it's winter, they may find that there's a prescription, maybe leave-in product that it's much thicker, that their hair loves. Because most times, the main character, especially for Afro-textured hairs, once it's winter, and any other hair type actually, to be honest, is that the hair will be more static and dry. And that's because, you know, it's the heat is in the house, you're putting woolly products on your woolly items on your hair or your neck, you're going outside, the weather's quite cold, so that those extreme temperatures does create a general rule for most hair types, which is it can become static, it can become dry or frizzy. Which is why I said, you'll leave it, to be honest, whatever routine that you're doing, just keep on doing it. Just op it with your leave-in conditioner. So I always have a tip with, if you're wearing woolly hats, if you're really good with your hands, you could just, you know, line your woolly hats with silk fabric, or you could just buy, there's some that out there that are already pre-lined. Yeah. You could do that if you want. If you're not really bothered, I used to try and do that, but I'm not very religious at doing that, because every time I change my hats every winter, I'm not in the mood to sew in a silk fabric. Or you could just get your leave-in conditioner just before you put your hat on and apply that around your edges, because that prevents that excessive friction from the dry hair.
Right.
Because the wool tends to pick. And most people find that the nape of their hair, the back of their hair in the winter dries out or breaks off. And that's usually from your coats and from your scarf.
Right, because it's like rubbing.
It's rubbing.
It's doing all of that.
Exactly. So you can't, to be honest, you can't avoid that. But my thing is just do the little things that will make a huge difference, which is, again, just a dab of your leave-in conditioner. And just, you know, it doesn't stop the friction, but it reduces the hair from pulling, or from the, sorry, not the hair from pulling, from the wool, from pulling any dry hair and just kind of picking at that. Because most times you'll find that you may not notice the tiny strands each time, but over time it kind of breaks off the ends.
Kind of like,
exactly. So those little things are things that would just make that huge, just that little thing. And it's just your leave-in conditioner. You're not going out there to get something special. Just apply that to your edges and your nape each time you're about to kind of go out or put any woolly products on your head or your neck.
Oh my God, amazing. You're brilliant. Thank you. Thank you so much. This is super, super helpful. And I hope this has helped demystify how to care for your hair during the winter months, during the really, really cold months. As usual, we remain at your disposal. Oh, the lovely Kerishani remains at your disposal. If you've got any questions.
Yeah, if you have any questions, book an appointment with Kara, and that would just... we can have a more in-depth chat, because most with the hair care, I always say to people, there's no one rule book. Everybody is different with what your hair needs. So it's not about, oh, my friend said this, or I saw this on YouTube, therefore I do it.
Yeah.
You need to figure out what your hair is saying, and we'll help you figure that out. What your hair is saying, what it's telling you, what's telling us. And then we can tailor like your routine towards that.
We've got a question here from Tonyin. She says, what exactly does the heat cap do?
So, I mean, the heat cap, depending on if it's the electric one or the ones that have the towel in it, and you put it, you have to put it in the microwave for a little while. What heat does, when you apply a deep conditioner, what heat tends to do, or, well, not extreme heat, but some sort of gentle heat, is that it would help open up. So think about your hair shaft just kind of like laying flat like that. And then when you apply heat, it kind of opens up. Again, think about a lily flower, right? Over time, it opens up. So that's pretty much what happens. It's like the shaft of your hair opens up like blossom, ready to receive or ready to absorb anything that is already on there. So when you put your deep conditioner on and you apply heat, which means your heat cap, or if you don't even have a heat cap, my little trick is your shower cap, and a warm towel over that, and then wrap it over that, it opens up the shaft of your hair.
How about steam rooms? Like if you go to a gym and like you've got a steam room.
If you go to a spa, if you're having a spa day, gym, just take your, what make your spa day or your gym day your wash day is even the best thing.
So
your hair. Yeah, but again, you're not there for more than 10 minutes, because you know that the steam in a steam room can be, or a sauna. Yeah. It's extreme. Yeah. It's quite extreme, and you can't even stay there for more than 10 minutes anyway.
Yeah, true.
And don't put a cap on. You don't even need the cap. Just wash your hair that day. But then the heat will just open up. So think about a flower. Opens up your hair shaft to absorb the product that you've already put there, which is your deep conditioner, and allows that to penetrate even deeper and further into your hair shaft. And once you rinse that off, it kind of... And most deep conditioners are meant to kind of fill in any gaps in your... so think about your hair shaft like in layers like that. So it's meant to fill that in. And that's what that does, or if it's meant to strengthen it or replenish the moisture in there. And it makes it work even better.
Okay.
That's just the general rule for that. But if you've got a spa day, make your spa day. I do that a lot. Spa days, I usually take all my products, wash my hair, go in the sauna. It's a spa day. I paid for it. If you're going to the gym on the gym day after your workout, which is even the best because you can wash off all the sweat, and then use your steam room or that. Put your deep conditioner on 10 minutes. If you can, I can't do more than 10 minutes in a steam room anyway. So, and even that, I probably have to come out twice.
That's too hot.
It's too hot. So you can just do that or 5 minutes and then just rinse off. And you're good. You're pretty much good to go. You're pretty much good to go. Yeah.
Sweet. Well, Tony, I hope that answers your question. But if you've got any more, please just ping us and we'll get you booked in for your Kara session. But I just want to say a huge thank you, Kemisade, for dropping so many gems this evening.
You're welcome.
I better let you go because I'm sure you're busy this evening. But huge thank you so much.
Oh, someone's got a question. Was it? Can you see it?
Ooh, we got one. I got, where is it?
It's come up now.
Ooh, I put a timer. Let's see. Does blow drying your hair every wash day damage the hair?
No. That's my simple question. No. Again, are you using extreme high heat on the temperature of your blow dryer? Just use cool setting. You can let your hair air dry for a few minutes before you do that, you know. But no, but as long as it's not just extreme and you're putting a heat protectant on before you do that and you're leaving conditioners there, it's not damaging. What happens is people use extreme heat or the wrong type of hair dryer. So,
okay, just to point there, Feebams, I guess like if your hair is starting to feel and smell, like, you know, like when it's too hot and it sort of smells like it's being burnt.
And if your blow dryer is more than, I don't want to say 5 years old, but if it's been more than 5 years old, 6 years old, then yeah, it's time to, because the technology for blow dryers are changing. So we don't get the ones that leave your hair looking crispy and feeling crispy. If you blow dry your hair and it's feeling crispy, then yeah, that's damaging. But the newer ones are much better, where the air, it's kind of like air cooling effect rather than extreme heat. So you need to look at the type of blow dryer that you're using.
Okay. Yeah. Amazing. Thank you. I hope that answers your question, B. And if there are no other questions, we better let this lovely lady go eat before she becomes hangry.
Hangry, and I need a chef. I don't want to cook. That's the whole bit.
You and me both. Anyway, thank you so much. See you soon. Till next time. All right. Bye.